Basically, this is a Q&A, which means like you guys can have Qs, I could have some A's, something like that. Or it's just me yammering for an hour. So I have been working in anime now for coming on 29 years. My assistant is texting me and saying, "Oh, are you at the event?" Yes, I am. Just one thing. Hand, isn't that the most obnoxious thing? I am not a trained monkey. Okay, I'll address that later on. I hate that term. I hate that term. Please don't use that. Call handler? That's awful. Ugh. Anyway, so fun fact, my first Otakon that I did in 1998 was at this hotel. So that was the last time I was at a convention in this hotel, in 1998. I have very dim recollections of that. The main thing that I remember is that they were screening a fan sub of In the Baby Galleon, and I had not seen it yet. And I remember coming down that escalator and seeing that there was a huge line of people to get into one of these rooms. And somebody asked me, "Hey Tiffany, they're going to be showing End of Evangelion, are you going to go watch it?" And I said, "Oh my gosh, no, have you seen how long the line is?" And this person looked at me and goes, "Tiffany, you don't have to wait in the line for that." And I was like, "I don't know about that. That doesn't sound right." I mean, I didn't know. So, yeah, back in the day, there was no guest relations department. All we told you when we were supposed to be somewhere that you could go in and watch something and not have to stay in the line. But anyway, that's what we're doing. So if you guys have questions about really just about anything, I would welcome those at any moment that you have them. So, my career, okay, go ahead.
How did you get into voice acting?
That's what I was going to just launch right into that, because it's usually a popular cue. My career in anime started back in February of 1994 in Houston, Texas. That's where 80 Films, 80 Vision was originally located. Well, not originally, I mean, it still is there, much to the misperception of many people, does definitely exist. Anyway, so my background was mostly theater, and I always really did have an interest in voiceover, voice acting. I didn't know how somebody might go about doing anything like that, you know. When I was a kid, I had a little tape recorder that I used to record sketches on with my friends, and we would be ridiculous characters and do terrible celebrity impersonations and stuff like that. But that was about as close as I ever came to doing any voice acting as a young person. And then we get to February of 1994, and it was a brand new company in Houston, 80 Vision, and they had just started importing some anime into America, and they were releasing it with subtitles. They had not dubbed anything, and they were going to dub their very first show, and they needed to find some actors. So this little company that was maybe a half a dozen people at the time, and ADV was being run quite literally out of a closet in John Ledford's video game store, Gametronics. And anyway, they were going to dub their first show, and they were like, "Wow, well, we've never hired actors. How do you find actors?" And they said to all of their friends, "If somebody knows some actors, then tell them that we're having these auditions." And then they also put an ad in that Help Wanted section of the Houston Chronicle. Not generally how people go about finding actors. But that that is for real what happened. So I got a call out of the blue from someone that I knew back in junior high, and he remembered, I guess, seeing me in school plays, and he said, oh yeah, these people, they're looking for actors, and I remember that you're an actor, and so I don't know if you'd be interested in that or not. I just thought, wow, yeah, that sounds awesome, I totally want to do that. So I called and made an appointment, and I went down to the auditions, and I got hired. And that's really how the whole thing got started for me. You know, being an actor and then kind of being at the right place at the right time, and you know, finding out about those auditions and really being at the ground floor of when anime dubbing started happening in Texas. And for those of you who don't know, really the majority of anime that's been dubbed for the last 28, 29 years has mostly been dubbed in Texas between Houston and then the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and for a few years even there was Austin. But yeah, there is a good bit of dubbing that happens in Los Angeles, and a teeny tiny bit in New York, not as much as probably there used to be. And, you know, then in Canada, there are dubbing studios in Vancouver and in Toronto. Yeah, but there's just really a few places where that's happening. So, that's how it all started for me. Yeah.
So, if I remember right, I think when they started doing the new Evangelion movies, Funimation started to recast it. At least for the first movie, and then eventually Amazon came in and brought in the old cast, the old cast. How did that come about?
When Funimation started working on 1.0, the first rebuild film, they did try to get some of the actors. By then, several years had already passed since we had done the TV series. A lot of people were sort of dispersed, and for some of the roles, like maybe Toji in the TV series, there were three different actors for Toji, so I guess they didn't really feel like, oh, it's super important to, you know, get, like, which Toji, because there was three of them. I mean, Brett Weaver, obviously. But, yeah, some of the people, either they weren't available, or they moved, or even like Kurt Stoll, who played Kinsuke, he many years ago just decided, no, I don't think I want to do any more anime. I mean, he's not really an actor. It was kind of something he did on the sidelines for a while and doesn't really do it anymore. Kendra Benham, who was the original Maya Ibuki, she also kind of gave up the whole acting thing. So, and then you have people like, you know, Amanda and Jason. Well, they had moved to Los Angeles, and Funimation is in Dallas, and so they just weren't going to they weren't going to make it financially, I mean, possible for that to happen. You know, Ray doesn't really talk very much, so you know that just, yeah, it just couldn't work out where. Because, I mean, they don't pay our transportation or anything like that. So when I was living in Houston and driving like 270 miles to get to Dallas and record up there, it's not like they're giving me a Shell gas card or something. You know, that's, however you get to the job, that's on you. So, yeah, Amanda had to buy a plane ticket from LA to Dallas. Stay in a hotel. There's just no way. I was really disappointed about that Amanda was recast. But, yeah, you know, then there were a few of us, like when they started doing 2.0, obviously I came in and recorded on 2.0 and 3.0 for Funimation. And I'd already been working with them for a while, so I was already had a relationship with Funimation, and I'd already driven up there. Other many years later, like last year, when the Dubbing Brothers is the studio who did the dub for the redubs for the rebuild and then the new Thrice Upon a Time movie, they decided that they really wanted to get as many like original cast members as possible, which was like really an important thing for them. And most principally to not do what Netflix did. That was kind of the overriding thing is like, let's look what Netflix did. Let's don't do that. Right, so they got, you know, some of the OG cast being me, Spike, Amanda, Allison, you know, John Swayze, who's not the original Gendo in English, but he has been doing it for a long time, some Latin version. And then, you know, some of the other cast members in the Amazon dub for the rebuild film. They were people like that Amanda had used in Evangelion, so they got to come back. And like Amy Seeley played Maya, either behind or Maya. So and we were all really excited. I mean, I was when I found out that it was going to be, you know, me, Spike, Amanda, and Allison. You know, that was gold for me, just knowing that it would be us again. Getting the gang back together, so that was really awesome for me.
Yeah, I watched a lot of older anime, a lot of stuff. Sometimes it was probably varying, but your crew, that you were part of for Evangelion was definitely one of the best. It came out of Asian, so it's really wonderful to see you again.
Oh, thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I know we really took a lot of time with it and were able to really just invest a lot of ourselves into it when we were doing that original dub. And for the most part, I mean, really dubbing now is just so different. It's so fast and you just don't get that amount of time with the characters. Back then in the 90s, we only dubbed two episodes at a time. So it took, you know, like a year or something to dub Evangelion. Whereas nowadays, a 26 episode series, the production time for the whole thing is probably like 6 weeks. You know, and I'm not saying that it took a year to record it. So do not misunderstand that I'm saying that we, you know, 40 hours a week, 52 weeks a year, no, not at all. But it's just, it was a lot more time that we had. And part of that, honestly, is technology, the recording ability that we had at that time. It was a lot slower. So that's definitely part of it. But I can remember so much of that recording on Ava, on the original, on Genesis Evangelion, just vividly. There were so many just crystal clear memories. Did you guys get lost?
A little bit.
Idiots. yeah. So,
So, it's not to say that 3 points are particular. Your quota to bring it on.
Yes. So appropriately named, you cannot redo. Yes, I have recorded it 3 times.
There was the theatrical
version that we did, and I say theatrical because it actually did. The first dub that we did for Funimation of 3.0 was in a limited release in movie theaters across the U.S. and Canada. I did not get to see it, and that really upsets me now because it's kind of just gone forever. Very ephemeral. Anybody who was there and saw it, that was it. You experienced it, and now it's gone. It's like a concert. And then I kept thinking, like, well, when is the DVD coming out? You know, when is it coming out? And there was no announcement. And then about a year later or something, it said, okay, well, we're redoing it. And I'm like, okay. did it all, we did it the third time, but I did get paid again, so. Yeah. And they changed one of my favorite lines, which is, it is simply the duty of the elite to protect the ignorant masses. So that line got changed. And what it got changed to, I can't even really remember, because it's like backwards. It's like, the ignorant masses must be protected by the elite. It's just stupid. When we got to that part in the script, and I said, oh, I know what this line is. And it's like, oh, okay. But then Kara kept making us change stuff that we were fixing. Like third boy. What the hell does that mean? Who's the first boy and the second boy? How can you have a third boy if there's no first boy, no second boy? Doesn't make any sense. Whatever. Yes. There is, by the way, an Evangelion panel tomorrow. So we can talk about all the Evangelion stuff tomorrow. Yes.
I'm not sure how much you want to do currently, if you still do a lot of work or whatever, but because my question is, if that's so, do you think that actors have a little bit less freedom to get into their characters, not just because of Zorro, because of, I guess, more of an emphasis on this has to be translated in a certain way, you're going to have, like, five people in Japan staring at you, making sure you do it right, because I've heard of stories like that, so I was just wondering, is there a big change in the way it used to be, like, versus the 90s and now as far as
that is still pretty rare. That's, in my experience, that's pretty rare that you have that level of supervision. And that said, we're not trying to screw this stuff up or change things around in a way that changes the meaning. We're not after that. We're not trying to do that. I mean, there are occasionally weird things, like Chris Patton's doing a panel about those stories, which was awesome. You should totally check that out. And that was one, obviously, they did intentionally change everything. But, you know, 99% of the anime is not that. But yes, your first point, you are exactly correct. There really is, it's so fast, and there is not as much time to get into character or to figure something out about the show. It's kind of like, you're in here, we're doing it, we're recording it right now, boom, 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 you know? So it's just so much faster now.
Is there a difference in performances? I mean, obviously, you know, professional to professional, but I kind of wonder, you know.
I mean, we do our best, but I can't help thinking that there must be some effect. I don't know. Yeah, there's just not as much time in the booth and with these characters, and you just really just got to knock it out. You know, time is money, and you've got to just crank this stuff out as fast as you can. And I feel like a lot of times maybe the scripts are not, there's not as much attention paid to the scripts, and that's an issue as well. There really haven't been too many shows that I've worked on that had like a crazy level of supervision. Evangelion has always been one of them. I mean, back when it was Gainax, and they wanted to have their fingers and everything back then, and Bakara is like that, and then to the 10th power. I mean, and not really even to make anything better, but just like because we say so. And that's just pretty much it. They literally proofed the first versions that we did of the rebuild movies by reading it, by looking at the script. So, like, here was the script that we started with, and then the director would, like, line through it and then put, like, what we actually said. So instead of listening to it and hearing our performances, basically they read a transcript. So, I hear Citizen Kane is good. Can I get a transcript of that? That's not a way to judge a performance in a movie. And a lot of the changes were, like I said, they're just because I say so, just because I can make you do this, just because I can change a line that's like a really popular line. It is simply the duty of the elite to protect the ignorant masses and make it be the, I don't know what changed to, but it was not good. It was not better. How did we say it? It was something that was like backwards. Cranky old lady. Yes, anybody? Yes.
So Funimation's business model seems to have been to license in Japanese animated television shows and in some cases, I guess, films, and
yes,
to adapt them for the American market. Was there ever consideration or discussion about developing American shows in that style for the native audience?
Well, yeah, but that would not be something, I mean, and that does happen, of course. I mean, you have something like Airbender, people refer to it being an anime, and it's not really an anime. Avatar: The Last Airbender, I guess I should say the whole thing. But yeah, the Funimation, that is not their milieu. That's not their niche. That's not, they don't make original animation. So that would be more like a Cartoon Network thing or something, you know, Hulu, whatever. That would be somebody else who's actually producing original content. So, you know, the studios like Sentai or Funimation, they are doing localized English language versions of shows that already exist.
Right.
So it's a completely different thing.
Did you?
But,
oh,
I was going to say, but what has been true for many years, decades even, is that it is not uncommon at all for an American licensor to go in and say, you know, they get a pitch on a show that's going to be coming out in Japan, and for them to be on board to finance it. So a lot of times these American companies are original financiers of a particular anime that is on in Japan. So that does happen. Or they might be behind something like getting a second season done of something that was really popular in the U.S. So those kind of things do happen.
What are some of the best directors that you work with? What do you think?
Well, even though he's annoying sometimes, I will say that Matt Greenfield, he always, even a lot of us will say, even if he drives you crazy sometimes, you know that the end result is going to be good. So, you know, somebody who is responsible for creating dubs and things like Lucy, Evangelion, Ross Vaughn, Noir, you know, it's hard to go wrong with those types. They're all really, really good. Some people, you know, I hate to like go down the list and start naming a lot of people because then it seems like I'm not favoring other people, but Mike McFarland, I always had a great relationship working with Mike, and I knew Mike through going to conventions, but he was the first director to hire me to work at Funimation back in 2004 on Case Closed. So he was the one who got me started working on projects at Funimation, and he and I just really hit it off, and I think, you know, we worked really, really well together. She only directed for a few years, but a lady named Sandra Crossa, she directed several shows for ADV, kind of around the 2004, 5, 6, that kind of time frame. Mabaraho, Kaleidostar, Hello Kitty, I think she directed Hello Kitty, yeah. Anyway, I always had a great time working with her. And I will not give you a list of directors that I did not interest. That will not happen. Because maybe they'll still hire me to come back someday. No, probably not.
I don't know if you'll be able to answer this or not, but just another general industry question, since you've had you know, certain different companies and everything. Do you think that the whole streaming wars and all these streaming services will eventually have an impact on the anime industry, the dub industry, everything like that? Because it seems like Netflix has too much power and they're scary at one point, but whatever your opinion of it, sometimes you're not some bad, it doesn't matter, but do you think that it's really impacting the industry, or do you think it's just a phase, or what do you think?
I mean, it definitely already is impacting the industry. When I started working in anime, we recorded two episodes of Anime at a Time. And the reason is because that's how many episodes were released on a videotape.
Yeah.
And that videotape would cost you $25 or $30 for those two episodes. And that's either subtitled or dubbed, not both. One or the other. This is the whole genesis behind that sub versus dub debate from the 90s. That's why it really all mattered, because it's like what you spend your money on. Because most otaku could not afford to buy both. So the truth is, the dubs outsold the subs like 10 to 1. But in any case, so that's 27, 28 years ago, you know, that's what anime cost. And a few years later, early 2000s, DVDs arrive. Now we're usually doing, let's say, an average of about 4 episodes on a DVD. Costs about $25 or $30 a DVD. So now you're getting, and it's subtitled and it's dubbed. Okay, and it may even have extra features and cool things like that. And maybe you get like stickers with it or whatever. Anyway. So now you're getting twice as much anime for the same price. Then pretty soon, you know, you're getting box sets and you're getting Blu-rays. And now you get, you know, you can buy a whole season for $80 or whatever it is. Now think about you're streaming with Crunchyroll or High Dive or whatever, and you spend, I don't know how much it is, $8, $10 a month?
High Dive is $3.
$3
a month.
$3 a month, okay. For unlimited anime. Right. So, I think I just answered the question for you. I mean, how do you even sort of parse that out to, like, how many, like, a penny or something an episode that the viewer is paying for? I mean, it's great for anime viewers, because you have access to so much content for so little money. You know, you could subscribe to all of the services and, you know, still spend less money than what an otaku was spending 15 or 20 years ago on anime, and to only get a few episodes, you know? So, I mean, that's really the impact that it's had on the industry, is that, yes, anime is very popular, you have big conventions like this, but where's the money that's going back into the industry to support all of that? Well, I mean, the money, where's the money coming in? You know, if you're paying $3 a month to watch unlimited anime versus $30 to watch two episodes, there's just not as much money coming in. And of course, it's also obviously very possible to watch this stuff and not pay for it, not pay $3 a month, just not pay anything, and just basically steal it. So, you know, that is an issue. So, yeah, streaming has had a big impact on it. Yes, it makes it more accessible to people, but as far as the money that's coming into the industry, it has had a dramatic impact there, a huge decrease, I guess. I mean, I don't know. I'm not an accountant, so I don't get to see all of the numbers of, you know, how many subscribers they have that are paying $3 and how that translates out. I don't know. Maybe it's gazillions.
From a consumer standpoint, like, since there's so many streaming services now, rights getting pulled all the time, and maybe actors changing, mm-hmm. and stuff with Fox like 100. hearing about that, like, does it make it more chaotic? Because it seems like everyone has to have their excuse. Loose right to this. You have season one here, season two here. You know, change the actors here.
That's very frustrating for the fans, really, because, yeah, I can see the issue there.
Translates over on the industry side, but might be a bit more chaotic.
Yeah, I mean, that's just something that actors do not have any control over, so however bothersome or annoying or whatever that might be, I can't affect that in any way. So I did get to record Evangelion 3.0 three times.
See, there you go.
Yeah. Did you have a question?
Sorry, my brain just crashed there.
I need to reboot.
Blue screen, yeah. What individuals have you worked with that you have found best brought out the skill sets of a multitude of people? Because it's easy for someone at the top to go, this is the way it is. I'm going to cross out this line from the transcript. But like being able to pull out the skill set of the general group is a much more nuanced proposition, I suppose.
Yeah, that's kind of a tricky question to answer. I mean, we don't work in a group setting, so it's just one actor in the recording studio with the director and the sound engineer. So as far as most directors are very, very open to those kind of suggestions. Like, you know, if a line isn't working or it seems weird or it's awkward or it's just a little too short or too long or something. Most directors are pretty open to that, tweaking the dialogue. And I don't mean changing a line from Shinji's an idiot to what did you have for lunch today? You know, it's not like that, you know. Most directors, that's a very common thing. That's not like any one person. That's a very common industry practice that we're able to make those kinds of suggestions for our characters, you know, because as an actor, I'm there, I feel like as the representative of my character and to be their advocate, their voice, and literally, but also, you know, figuratively, that I always want to, get what's best for that character and what's going to be ultimately beneficial for the show. And of course, that's, you know, depending on who you're working with and how well you know them. I mean, if it's somebody that you've worked with like gazillions of times that you've known for decades or possibly once married to, it can be easier than other times. But if I have a suggestion for something that I think is going to make the show better, I'll always say it. Yes.
Have you worked on anything recently, and if so, can you talk about it?
I guess what I've worked on most recently the Girls in Panzer films, Dostanale. There are six films. We've done three of them so far. I also did a couple of little tiny bits in I'm Quitting Heroing. So if you can find me in there, kudos to you. Let's see. And I was just looking at it yesterday, but there's a visual novel that I worked on a year ago that I keep checking to see if it's released, and it's not. Because this would be their second one. They released one, and every time I look, it's like, oh no, it's still that same one, and it still is like coming soon. So, not really. tiny bit. Kaka Guru. It's a little tiny bit, but it was previously dubbed elsewhere. Go figure. Yeah.
You mentioned the recording Evangelion 3.03 times. How did that process like work? Like how they run you down? Like if there was anything different between all of them?
Yeah, well, there was, for one thing, a lot of time in between. The years get, it's a blur. But we recorded, do not hold me to this, but I think we recorded 3.0 the first time in the summer of 2013. That feels right. It got released in movie theaters in the spring, or sometime early 2014. And I thought, oh, you know, surely soon it's going to be on DVD. Crickets. There's nothing. 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 And, maybe sometime in the middle of 2014, I'm told, oh, they want us to redo it. We didn't redo it until, I think, well, maybe we did redo it in the summer of 2014, but it ended up not getting released until 2016. And I couldn't figure out because we had recorded it, and it still doesn't make any sense to me. I have no idea why after we re-recorded it, because you're not making money on this thing. You're not making money on it until you're actually selling it. So why is it just sitting in a drawer somewhere or whatever? I mean, I don't know. That was just baffling to me. And then, of course, when we did it the third time, that was last year, early last year, when we redid it for Amazon Prime. So, yeah.
You mentioned you recently did some voice acting for a visual novel. How different is that compared to doing voice acting for an anime?
Well, very different because I was not matching any mouth flaps. It was only my second visual novel that I've done. But yeah, don't have to match any mouth movement, so I loved. Visual, but not flappy. Yes.
Do you find need to do, or does the industry have a need for folks to do adaptations when there are no mouth flaps? Or do they just work with the translations?
No, you still need a script adapter because you still have issues of like how long the line will be, for one thing. And the only show that I can think of off the top of my head that had no mouth flaps in it, it was a half hour short film. Oh my gosh, this was like 15 years ago. I cannot think of what it was called, but everybody in the show was a kid, were kids, and they all wore these fox masks. And so there were, what was it called?
Kakarimbo.
Yes.
Kakarimbo, thank you. Right. It was a great movie, but no, you didn't see anyone's mouth because, but still, the characters are all having dialogue with one another, and sometimes the way something is translated from Japanese into English, the translation might be shorter or longer than the amount of time that character is speaking, because even though you're not seeing their mouth moving, there are visual cues as to who's talking and who's saying something, and so you still are in those constraints. And even though, and I've worked with a lot of really great translators, even though they're bilingual, it is not their job to write something that a human being will say out loud. And so if you think about that,
they're not necessarily good at dialogue.
Right. That's not their job. That is not their job. Their job is like, this is what they said, here you go. That's their entire job. It doesn't have to be fluid necessarily. It doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be anything other than this is what they're saying.
Right.
You don't speak Japanese, so I'm going to tell you what they said. Here it is in English. That's it. So before I ever did script adapting for dubs, what I actually did for a few years is I did script adapting for subtitles, which was a lot easier because you don't have to match the mouth flaps. But it was just more about like polishing it and making it succinct and easily readable. But yeah, you still really do need a script adapter. It's a different job than translating. They're two different jobs. There are probably some people who can do both. I would say not very many though. I don't personally know. Not casting any aspersions on anyone's abilities. They're just two different jobs. That's all. They're just two different jobs. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there a character that you voiced like in the past that's not relatively known, but you want people to know that character?
A character that I voiced that's not well known?
Yeah, but you want them to know.
Ooh. Well, I have a little bit broader answer. Ditto Coil is a wonderful show. I mean, I really can't even say enough good things about what a terrific show it is. And so I was the script adapter for that show, and I also played several different roles in it. But yeah, I just wish more people had seen Ditto Coil. It only came out in 2016, so it's not a super old show. Actually, it came out in Japan, I think, in 2007, but it did not get released here until 2016. But it is an absolutely terrific show. The main characters are all kids, and so it's very much told through that lens. The story is told through their eyes, and they're, for the most part, the characters are like 12 years old. There's a couple of characters that are teenagers, and then the adults, there's a couple of adults, they're mostly props. I mean, they could be like the teacher in Charlie Brown. But Ditto Coil, definitely. It's a show that's set kind of in a near future time. And I will say that since the show was made in 2007, we've basically gotten to where they had predicted in the time of this show, other than the part about the glasses. So instead of people using phones, at least what's really popular with the kids is they have these glasses that they use. And it acts as their interface with the internet, and it's also an augmented reality like Pokemon Go. And in fact, when the show was released in 2016, that's when Pokemon Go was immensely popular. And it's like, oh my gosh, they predicted Pokemon Go. So to me, the fascinating aspect of the show is thinking about what is real and does that matter? Like, what makes something real? And can you have a genuine relationship with things that are not in the physical world? Just absolutely a terrific show. I can't even recommend it highly enough. It's one of my favorite of all time. It's a great show. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, you talk about a movie earlier. For everybody else, is there a project or franchise ongoing or new that you would like to be a part of?
Something ongoing that I would like to be a part of. Well, I told you earlier, not necessarily for artistic reasons particularly, but I would love to do something in Dragon Ball Z. Or Dragon Ball, whatever, you know, all the Dragon Balls. I've never gotten to be in Dragon Ball, so I kind of wish that I could be in Dragon Ball. That would be good.
You could also apply it to video games.
Well, okay. If we're gonna go to video games, there are a lot of Evangelion video games, and I really wish that they would all get made in English. That would be fantastic. That would be great. I would love that. Because I really, in Evangelion, I've only gotten to do, you know, the TV series and the movies, and that's it. Whereas in Japan, I mean, Miyamura has done so much stuff, all these different pachinko games and video games and toys and all this other stuff, and yeah, I haven't got to do any of that. Yes. How are we doing? Oh, just got a few minutes left. Yes.
I was just curious when you did Asuka. If you had an inspiration of what kind of voice you wanted to do for her, like any actor, whatever animes?
I mean, I guess I was really kind of inspired by Yuko Miyamura in my performance, and she definitely was an inspiration for me. And going back to a previous question about taking your time, I can remember my first recording session as Asuka. We spent a lot of time just establishing the character, how she was going to sound, whether she would or would not have a German accent. That was a consideration. It actually was. That whole process of getting to spend that much time with the character, and then I remember recording the first episode, and then we went back and we listened to it and made sure everything was, consistent, and that we had her the way that we wanted her to be, and before going on and doing the next episode, we're like, okay, she's set now. This is Asuka. This is what Asuka sounds like. So sassy. Well, we don't have that kind of time anymore. So. Yeah.
Between all of Evangelion, like, what would you say would be the most standout moment? Like, you keep always looking back and really, like, really, really appreciating that you did a certain moment in it.
Probably the breakdown scene in the Evangelion. I don't want to die scene. That was pretty tough. But and I hope that we don't redo it. Screaming. But no, I think it's fine. Like, I don't think that they needed to redo the TV series for Netflix. We made a perfectly good version. As my ex-husband likes to say, we did the version that everyone likes.
Yeah.
That you had to read the movies three times. So when you're coming back for the next session, how are you approaching that? Are you trying to do it completely fresh? Are you trying to recreate what you did before? How does that process work?
I'm just trying to stay true to Asuka, but when it comes to the dialogue, it's really so much I can't change, which is incredibly frustrating. See, 2.0, we've only done twice. Likewise, 1.0, except obviously I'm not in it. But it is the best one. I mean, out of the rebuilds, 1.0 is the best one. It just is. Yeah, I mean, it's just, for me, it's just all about staying true to Asuka. That's it. Just try to be her advocate.
I was thinking about that. What are your feelings on the other video from, especially the last one?
The other, what, the other rebuild films. The Netflix or?
The rebuild films.
Oh, I don't know, I mean, he had a, you know, different version of Evangelion that he wanted to tell. I'm not sure, I don't really think he knew what it was going to be when he started making those movies, you know? And, like, when the third one came out, and it was just, like, what the hell was that, you know? And no one understood it. I think he brooded on that for a long time, so, I don't know.
Did you ever have that moment in all of your roles in your time, the one role or even two roles that you felt as you were getting into like the industry and just kind of finding your way? You got the role and you felt like, this is me. This is my place. This is my center of the sun.
Yeah, I would say yes, but I don't think it's necessarily a specific character, even Asuka. Although I feel so closely connected with her. I was probably working in anime for, I don't know, many, many years before I just really, it dawned on me, what I like to call Tiffany Epiphany, that, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I am a voice actor. This is what I do. This is my thing. And, I had that realization many years ago that I don't really care about doing anything on camera that's not necessarily really appealing to me. It's a whole lot of standing around and waiting and, you know, I don't have patience for that anymore. that's a great question, but I don't know if that sounds really arrogant or something, say, I was born to do this, but, I did, how much time do we have? Oh, we got like a minute. I genuinely had like a full-on existential crisis when the whole Netflix thing was happening, and it was getting redubbed, because I never imagined that. I never thought, oh yeah, somebody's going to want to redo it. It's like, people like it. Sorry to be self-congratulatory, but people like it. People like our dub. And it just was baffling to me. Even if I had been hired, which thank God I wasn't, because the script is awful, and I would have had to say all of that crap. But I didn't want to get paid to do it again. We already did it. It's good. I stand by it. We don't need to do it again. You know? I thought, oh my gosh, you know, this is going to be on Netflix, which is a huge platform, and then all of these millions of people will watch it on Netflix, and they'll just watch that version, and what's ever going to happen to the version that we did, and it'll just be lost forever, and everybody will just love this new cast, and think that they're great, and just forget all about us, and I mean, really, I'm telling you guys, because I thought, man, if I don't know who I am if I'm not Asuka. I know that sounds dramatic, but I'm an actor like that. she's just so much part of me, and I get messages from people all the time. I mean, even like the story that you shared with me earlier today, that is so impactful to me. When I meet somebody at a convention, or they send me an email, they share some personal story like that. I mean, that is so profound, you know? And Asuka is what gives me that feedback. It's like, and to me, I just felt like they were taking her away from me. But But, you know, eventually I realized, no, they're not taking Asuka away from me. They cannot take Asuka away from me. I'm still Asuka. They're not. And somehow, you know, fans are not beating down the doors to, you know, knock me out of the way. Like, we have to have the new cast. So, yeah, I guess it did not go so well for them. As I said in a very long email to one of the executives, surely this is a feather in your cap.